Hey everyone, welcome back to another Hardware News Recap for the week. We obviously had the Ryzen 3 3100 and 3300X review this week, so you can check those reviews out if you want to learn about those. But in the news, we have Intel Alder Lake, and potentially it looks like a new socket for that. We're talking about Cyberpunk's case modding competition, NVIDIA working on splitting chip orders between TSMC and Samsung, presumably for Ampere and maybe Hopper, and the FCC being forced to surrender its server logs after presumably it posted fake internet comments on its own comment form about net neutrality. So good job, FCC. Let's get into it. Before that, this video is brought to you by Gigabyte Aorus RTX 2080 Ti Extreme. The RTX 2080 Ti Extreme is built with a triple axial cooling solution and ready for anyone interested in intermediate GPU overclocking, although it's also up for gaming out of the box. The Gigabyte 2080 Ti can reach the higher performance range required to play games at frame rates at and beyond 144 FPS, coupled particularly well with games like Call of Duty Warzone, Rainbow Six Siege, and other competitive FPSs. Gigabyte's Extreme is built to be a looker for system builders going for extra visual flair. Learn more at the link in the description below. We'll start off by talking about the Cyber Up Your PC competition that Cyberpunk 2077's team is running. So CDPR, the developers, recently announced that they're hosting a PC case modding competition themed around Cyberpunk 2077 and around the theme of the future is recyclable. This is actually something we're going to be working on, our own case mod, to not to submit it to the competition, but just to for fun in the same theme. And in this early stage of the contest, which is open until May 17th, the CDPR team is asking for submissions of drawings or mock-ups of a case mod that you want to execute. And then they're planning to pick five people from that list of submissions and pair those five people up for the best designs with some case modders to actually make it a reality. The plan, it looks like, is for the contest to be judged on the following criteria for the entries. One, it has to include recycled material, and they list old PCBs as an example. Two, it has to feature a mega corporation logo or a game logo from Cyberpunk 2077, which the team has made available in an asset pack. And three, they'd like to see themes from the game somewhere, like the fact that rich and poor live adjacent to one another in the game's city. CDPR is asking for a front, a left, and a right image of the mockups. Presumably you can use any tools you want for this, so maybe physical pen and paper or 3D modeling software or something similar. And we're good friends with a lot of the case modders in the industry, Bob Stewart included, who do a lot of the really advanced mods for show floors. Typically, case modders will work with companies to present a new product, and then we get the fun of just seeing the actual mod. So it's good to see that side of the industry get more attention, especially from a major company in the gaming industry, not just the PC hardware industry. And we'll link that that submission form in the description, in the show notes below, if you want to work on your own Cyber Up Your PC mod. Okay, follow up on picometers versus nanometers. In the interest of addressing a couple of points from last week's news episode, there was a really interesting research paper that was released talking about how to rework the definition of what really is a semiconductor at its core specs, outside of just a single nanometer number, or if you prefer, a picometer number, or whatever it is. Because one of the problems is that it's not as simple as just the gate width. One of the points we addressed from last week was about how seven individuals and companies that worked on this research paper, including a researcher from TSMC, who presumably all actually know what they're doing, commented on nanometers being, one, not representative of what's actually going on anymore because density and other factors are a consideration. So they've devised a new formula to talk about semiconductors. And then two, running out of nanometers. And a lot of our commenters, who presumably know a lot more than TSMC and other people who design silicon, pointed out that something called picometers exist. And yes, believe it or not, we actually know about these fabled picometers. We've heard of them in textbooks. They're rare, but they're out there waiting. So we noticed the research piece that proposed the LMC density benchmark to supplement the nebulous node naming scheme that exists now got a lot of traction, which is great. However, some seemed to miss the point, prompting questions as to whether we and the researchers realized that A, numbers read decimals, which are used every day, go below zero, and B, that picometers exist. And as we noted from the LMC research paper we were quoting, the concern isn't about running out of numbers, believe it or not. Some might say there is an infinite supply of those. No. In fact, the concern was about using a single digit to represent an entire process. Now, additionally, as a minor concern, as far as these researchers and engineers are concerned, but a major one for marketing, an additional concern here is that when you convert from one unit of measurement to another, you're going to change the size of the numbers that you're representing. So let's just say there's a, for whatever reason, a 0.5 nanometer process that exists. Sure, you could call it 500 picometers, but good luck explaining that to consumers. By the one that's 500 or the one that's 0.5, after you've spent decades training them, that lower is better. And obviously, we made the transition into nanometers previously. For example, in the 90s, we had micrometers or microns, if you prefer. But anyway, the problem with simply trading nanometers for picometers is that you're just replacing one arbitrary number with another. So yes, obviously, the industry could say picometers instead of nanometers, but that doesn't fix the problem. The problem isn't the unit of measurement and running out of single-digit, clean, non-decimal numbers. The problem is that it's a pointless measurement, and that's what they're trying to fix. Okay, so the underlining point in the research paper is that measuring the minimum gate length of a transistor in silicon is no longer suitable for gauging the true advancements of a chip. Once upon a time, it used to be that simple, sort of. As simple as giving a pile of sand brains ever was, anyway. Gate length used to be a fairly honest way to measure a manufacturer's ability to pack transistors. A 90 nanometer manufacturing process would mean that 90 nanometers was the minimum transistor gate length that could be achieved with that process. However, it's getting harder to shrink transistors and gate lengths in a given die area, and advances, especially internode advances, are further muddying the waters. For instance, TSMC currently has no fewer than three iterations of 7 nanometer. It has N7, N7P, and N7 Plus. All the while, the number ascribed to a process node can actually be smaller than the minimum gate length it's meant to represent. This is because not all companies measure gate length the same way. Another point the paper brought up, but commenters didn't actually read it, so they just went on to insist that everyone should use picometers. This is why Intel claims its 10 nanometer is comparable to TSMC's 7 nanometer, and that its 7 nanometer will be competitive with TSMC's 5 nanometer. Process nodes are simply not standard, and the numbers attached to them are not wholly representative of the silicon they produce. They've become more marketing these days than they have anything else. Which brings up another point. It's unlikely that any chip maker wants to advertise their silicon on the basis of a picometer measurement. For years, again, to recap, consumers have been conditioned into thinking that smaller equals better. And when you start changing the scale, 10,000 versus 10 is going to really confuse a lot of people on the marketing side. So all that said, it's why semiconductor manufacturing needs a holistic density metric, which is what this paper was trying to push. And it's one that can accompany whatever node numbers are being pushed by TSMC, Intel, Samsung, GlobalFoundries, et al. And also the paper was worked on by a lot of researchers from different organizations, not just one silicon manufacturer, so there's less concern about creating a metric which is in some way biased towards better representing one company than another, because it's a collective effort from the industry and from the universities involved. Okay, I think we've recapped that enough. Next one, Intel Alder Lake and LGA1700, now that Comet Lake S is known and spoiled and Comet Lake H parts have arrived, this may be debatable depending on which part you're talking about. Now that they've arrived, we'll need another Intel platform to speculate about for the next year, and it looks like that's going to be called Alder Lake, and to a lesser extent, Rocket Lake S, which we've already talked about a bit. So we know Rocket Lake S is set to succeed Comet Lake S in the immediate future, and we also have a pretty good idea that you're supposed to be able to socket those CPUs into the Z490 motherboards. We'll see if that actually happens, but that's the current understanding. That should use the same LGA 1200 socket as Comet Lake S on the 10 series that's coming out shortly. And Rocket Lake is also thought to be based on Intel's Willow Cove core design, finally moving to the coves that we talked about a couple years ago when Intel had that press event. And that would be the same cores that Tiger Lake uses and come with an overhauled I/O, or PCIe Gen 4. Some Z490 motherboard designs more or less confirm Intel's future plans to support PCIe Gen 4 with Z490. Gigabyte has already confirmed Rocket Lake S will drop into its Z490 boards. And while the 400 series chipsets may not natively support PCIe Gen 4, many boards have the necessary components, such as timers and redrivers, to facilitate some Gen 4 functionality. Sitting further out and succeeding Rocket Lake S is Alder Lake S. According to LitTech, a supplier of Intel's VRTT tool software and voltage regulation test tools in the Asia-Pacific area, an LGA1700 interposer exists for Alder Lake S. Furthermore, according to Twitter sleuth Koma Kansaka, the ADLS LGA1700 socket measures allegedly 45mm by 37.5mm, and assuming this is true, that means LGA1700 would be decidedly more rectangular than the LGA1200 socket that we can actually show now from our Z490 boards we've received. That one measures 37.5mm by 37.5mm. So that, of course, means not only new boards, but probably new coolers would be in order for Alder Lake S. While NVIDIA is suggesting that everyone get amped marketing for its upcoming GTC keynote on May 14th, we're all but certain NVIDIA plans to take the wraps off of its next generation GPUs at this point. The Ampere architecture is what's currently, believe it or not, presumed to be the thing we are getting amped for, otherwise that would be embarrassing. And while we don't expect any GeForce-related announcements at the show, because they're pretty rare these days, we can expect to see what exactly NVIDIA has planned. And with that, the rumor mill has certainly not been idle. So an interesting rumor picked up by PC Gamer, and we will again firmly state rumor here, suggests that Ampere could mark a shift in segmentation. NVIDIA, to a certain extent, segments its consumer and professional products with different architectures. Volta was primarily aimed at professional users, and that was about it. Pascal and Turing were largely consumer-oriented with GeForce cards, but they also featured some Quadro and Tesla cards. However, Ampere is rumored to be both a consumer and a professional architecture. Additionally, Ampere's ray tracing is alleged to be several times what Turing is capable of, and that Ampere will effectively kill off the GTX branding with that, and with the Tensor and RT cores being distributed up and down the product stack. Furthermore, Ampere is said to herald the arrival of ray tracing at more economical prices and forego the RTX 20 series sticker shock. And also, if this happens, NVIDIA will have addressed the RTX on performance hit for ray tracing, or at least the initial one. We'll see how the games adapt, of course. Next one, NVIDIA splitting chip orders between TSMC and Samsung. In a separate report by Digitimes on NVIDIA's Ampere and Hopper, which should be following Ampere, loosely translated by Twitter user Retired Engineer, it looks as if NVIDIA has slept on AMD and TSMC's partnership, and so it's splitting orders. It looks like Ampere will go between TSMC and Samsung, which is a sensible move if true. Digitimes notes that NVIDIA will tap TSMC's 7-nanometer EUV N7 Plus process, yes, we're using nanometers again, for its high-end SKUs, while funneling orders to Samsung's aggressively priced 7-nanometer and 8-nanometer marketed processes. While we don't know exactly what 7-nanometer process NVIDIA will be using from Samsung, Samsung's 8-nanometer LPP and LPU process largely serves as a bridge between 10 and 7 and doesn't use EUV. Furthermore, NVIDIA was supposed to already have booked some of TSMC's 5-nanometer capacity for Hopper, which is the architecture set to succeed Ampere. This isn't confirmed yet, but Digitimes reported that TSMC was expecting strong results for first half 2020 due to an influx of orders for its 5-nanometer process from AMD and NVIDIA. We expect that AMD's Zen 4 and Genoa will also be based on TSMC's 5-nanometer, but we can't be sure what NVIDIA has planned for it outside of probably Hopper. It also seems like NVIDIA could be trying to outbuy AMD at 5-nanometer. AMD seems to have become TSMC's premier partner, at least in this space, for 7-nanometer. Obviously, Apple's in there as well. And that supposedly leaves NVIDIA somewhat out in the cold. So the rumors were circulating throughout 2019 that NVIDIA could be courting Samsung for a silicon purchase for 7-nanometer GPUs, and that might have been an attempt to bait TSMC into lower prices. AMD seemingly bought the unclaimed 7-nanometer capacity at that point, and AMD was also able to lay claim to the first 7-nanometer GPU, something that probably irks NVIDIA. Next up, back in 2017, the FCC invited public comments regarding the demise and future of gutting net neutrality. The Ajit Pai-led FCC did this under the guise of pretending to care about what anyone had to say, and it was simply a matter of formality. Pai was obviously not going to let net neutrality survive. So the FCC had its dog and pony show, and things got interesting. The FCC was flooded with millions of comments, many in favor of upholding net neutrality regulations. However, many comments, often in favor of dismantling net neutrality, were fake. Some even assumed identities of the deceased Yikes. This immediately sparked demands for server logs to investigate the IP addresses tied to fake internet comments. The FCC went as far as to claim that the public comment process suffered a massive DDoS attack, which turned out to be a flagrant lie. The FCC moved on to roll back net neutrality with a 3-2 vote, and in its place enshrined the Restoring Internet Freedom Order. This order removed the Title II utility classification from ISPs and stripped the FCC of any power to police ISPs and instead defaulted to the FTC for regulation, and another problem entirely. The Restoring Internet Freedom Framework, named in the most double-speak way possible, also contains other spectacular BS. For example, it claims that net neutrality is killing innovation and stifling investment with heavy-handed regulations, and that the FCC's new rules would tighten the transparency requirements for ISPs. And as someone who pays $900 a month for internet at my office, that's worse than my house, I can tell you that I'm not so sure that it's stifling investment. I think they've got plenty of money. Anyway, thus far, the FCC has dodged having to surrender server logs, but not anymore. After denying a pair of New York Times reporters access to the server logs, the reporters filed a lawsuit against the FCC under the Freedom of Information Act, and they won. A judge has ordered the FCC must now provide the server logs, and of course, this move didn't come without significant pushback from the FCC to try and keep the logs hidden. The FCC maintained that handing over the server logs would represent an unwarranted invasion of personal privacy, presumably assuming the identity of the deceased to make your internet arguments about net neutrality wasn't one of those. But anyway, the judge presiding over the case determined that the FCC failed to prove how the disclosure would actually harm anyone, and so the judge ruled that the logs must be made available and that the damage, if there were any, would be outweighed by having the information available to the public. So we'll now need to see what happens in the coming weeks. The judge apparently said that the determination here was to see if the FCC's decision making is, quote, vulnerable to corruption. I can answer that. Next one, Apple's T2 chip. In 2018, Apple started shipping certain products like the MacBook Air, MacBook Pro, and Mac Minis with controversial T2 security coprocessors that seemed a great way to thwart right to repair. Fast forward to today, and that premonition seems to have come true. In a report by Vice, many recyclers and refurbishers are claiming to be unable to repair or restore MacBooks due to the nature of the T2 chip inside these models, in addition to software locks requiring official Apple diagnostic software. Quote, by default, you can't get to recovery mode and wipe the machine without a user password, and you can't boot to an external drive and wipe that because it's prohibited by default. John Bumstead, a MacBook refurbisher, told this to Motherboard, saying further, quote, because T2 machines have no removable hard drive and the drive is simply chips on the board, this default setting means that a recycler, or anyone, can't wipe or reinstall a T2 machine that has default settings unless they have the user password. So of course, shout out to Lewis Rossman, who's a great source for more information on this matter if you want it, but the short of it is that the T2 chip validates any hardware changes in post-repair boot, and it detects if any changes have been made that the proprietary Apple software hasn't been run. So this then renders the device inoperable, despite being, from a hardware perspective, completely fine. And Bumstead from that quote also mentioned that Apple's Device Enrollment Program, or DEP, is a program that delivers software updates and proprietary company software, and it's a nightmare for independent repair shops. Without a way to simply wipe drives or make repairs, many MacBooks, some less than 2 years old, are being scrapped. Quote, the irony is that I'd like to do the responsible thing and wipe user data from these machines, but Apple won't let me, said Bumstead in a tweet. Quote, literally the only option is to destroy these beautiful $3,000 MacBooks and recover the $12 each they're worth as scrap. This underlines Apple's resistive stance on right to repair and has given rise to the Apple jailbreak community, such as Checkrain. The community is based on the Checkmate exploit, and that's an unpatchable boot ROM exploit used to jailbreak iOS devices. Its recent releases have been used to demote the T2 chip and Macs. While such workarounds are valuable, they shouldn't be required. As the e-waste pile grows, so too does the need for comprehensive right-to-repair legislation. That said, with thousands of $3,000 MacBooks that are 2 years old lying around, maybe that's an idea for the Cyber Up Your PC contest. Just take a nail gun and bolt a bunch of them to the outside of a case. Certainly increase the value of the case. Ryzen Pro 4000 and the new socket AM4 roadmap in discussion now. So AMD announced its newest line of commercial processors, first the Ryzen 3 series and now the Ryzen Pro 4000 lineup. Unlike the Ryzen 4000 mobile chips, the Pro line targets business and enterprise deployments where AMD needs more spread if it wants to continue competing. And that's with specific features not present in AMD's consumer lineup of AMD Ryzen offerings. The Ryzen Pro 4000 doubles the core and thread count over the last Pro iteration, with offerings scaling up to 8 core 16 threads. There will be new SKUs in the form of the R7 Pro 4750U, 8 core 16 thread, we're going for Intel naming apparently, the R5 Pro 4650U, 6 core 12 thread, the R3 Pro 4450U, 4 and 8, and the U suffix denotes a 15-watt TDP. All SKUs here come with integrated Vega graphics. Ryzen Pro comes with business-oriented security features like Memory Guard, as well as OS and OEM-specific security features like Windows Secured Core PC and Lenovo's self-healing BIOS. Additionally, AMD shared an update on its socket AM4 roadmap. While heavy on marketing and light on relevant details, AMD did divulge that current X570 and B550 chipsets would support Zen 3. This will require a BIOS update, obviously, and they also noted that it has no plans to backport Zen 3 to any chipset pre-X570, so 470, 450, 320, and AMD has already had issues with maintaining backwards compatibility on AM4 due to storage limitations with BIOS ROM chips on AM4 motherboards, so not exactly a surprise. That's going to wrap it up for this week's show. Go watch our coverage of the Ryzen 3 3100, 3300X, and the B550 boards if you haven't seen it. Subscribe for more. Go to store.gamersnexus.net to grab one of our mod mats. Running really low on stock, wasn't expecting to sell through so fast, but they're on the store now if you want one. And we'll see you all next time.